2.5 miles long, 1,000 feet high, and 120,000 tons of high-strength steel. Challenged by typhoon and earthquake, it's the longest, heaviest, and most expensive suspension bridge ever built. Now, the world's longest bridge on Modern Marvels. It's one of the most violent waterways in the world. Wrecked by typhoons, cursed with driving seas, and with currents reaching 15 feet per second, it's the Akashi Strait in Japan's inland sea. Long a major barrier to uniting northern and southern Japan, this 2.5 mile watery divide is now spanned by the mightiest bridge in the world. The most technologically advanced suspension design ever built, the Akashi Kaikyo Bridge.
The Japanese were presented with a very interesting challenge in the Akashi Straits. It's a relatively narrow strait. It's a major shipping channel. 1,400 commercial vessels that pass through the straits every single day. Coupled with that, then, is the currents or the flow of water through the Akashi Straits.
The Akashi Channel was a major challenge to Japan's bridge builders. The strait is over 360 feet deep. The intense currents that course through it cause violent flows at the surface and rapid erosion on the seabed. It is crowded with both fast-moving freight and stationary fishing vessels. And in the center of this, the engineers proposed to situate two nearly 1,000-foot-high bridge towers and join them with a record-breaking 12,828-foot span, which would link north to south.
Economic development is very important to the Japanese, and of course the populated areas of Tokyo and Osaka have the population density. The Japanese want to open up for economic development many of the other parts of their country, and so to do that they have to get from the population centers out into what was once the hinterlands. And so they established a transportation network comprised largely of rail and highway. The Japanese take that experience that they developed on the other bridges that they built in the Honshu Shikoku bridge projects, leading to what is now the longest suspension bridge in the world.
These mini bridge projects have all been designed to face a final immense challenge: earthquakes. And of all the natural enemies posed by the environment of Japan, none is so feared or deadly as the quakes that shake the island nation frequently. Most of them are small, passing almost unnoticed. But on the early morning of January 17, 1995, the Great Kobe earthquake crashed through the Akashi Strait into the slumbering city.
Then the Kobe earthquake occurred. When we surveyed the central line of the bridge, we discovered that it was slightly off the straight line.
Today, this magnificent bridge connects the main island of Japan with its southern cousins. Traffic crosses its six lanes day and night in all kinds of weather. And below, hundreds of ships carrying all kinds of commercial cargo pass unimpeded. But it was not always so. Early in its history, Japan was a nation divided by and bounded by water. In the mid-1800s, attempts were made to bring Japan into parity with the West. With Britain entering the Victorian Age and the Industrial Revolution sweeping America, Japan looked to the West for technical inspiration and expertise. By the 20th century, modern steamships had begun to link the many islands of the Japanese archipelago. But ferries and smaller vessels often fell victim to the whims of weather and sea conditions. By the late 1800s, Japanese engineers were traveling to the United States and Great Britain to observe the building of some of the great suspension bridges of that time, including the Brooklyn Bridge in New York. They took this expertise home to Japan, but it would be nearly 60 years before it would be put into practice on very large projects. By the late 1930s, plans for large-scale bridge construction were on the drawing boards. but World War II would divert resources, manpower, and willpower from the task. By the time it was over, 2 million of Japan's sons and daughters were gone, and the nation lay in ruins.
All of their efforts really began post-World War II. The Japanese began their quest for building large bridges and structures spanning the straits, spanning the waters, the seas of Japan. In about the early 1950s, and what the Japanese do is they take a large project and they research it, they practice, they build that bridge, and from that bridge they learn a lot more. They take that experience that they developed on that bridge and they turn it into the other bridges that they built in the Honshu Shikoku bridge projects.
In the 1950s, the future of Japan's economy depended on linking the country's sprawling infrastructure.
We need the infrastructures. We have so many islands separated by sea, so that in order to connect each side, we need bridges.
But the seaways of Japan would not be easily bridged. Many of these waters, the prime lifeline of commerce for the island nation, are infamous for their strong currents and foul weather. This made boat traffic unreliable, but building a bridge to replace it seemed a daunting task. While other narrower routes between the islands had been spanned by bridges, by the late 1980s, the Akashi Strait was still served by ferry boat. The government wanted to open this one last key route to the south, if they could.
The Akashi Bridge is just a huge project that had never been attempted from the magnitude of scale. So a lot of the technologies that worked before, a lot of the standard construction technologies, a lot of the design criteria had to be modified, had to be redeveloped, and had to be tailored specifically to this creation, the Akashi Bridge.
Bridging the treacherous Akashi Strait was easier said than done. Home to both severe wind and waves, a bridge here would have to be designed to withstand the worst of these combined forces. The Akashi Kaikyo Bridge would be the last and longest span in this violent environment. But what kind of bridge should be built?
When looking at span lengths so great, over 1 kilometer, a suspension bridge is the only viable structural type capable of spanning such great distances.
But structural considerations were not the only challenge. Japan is a country with a keenly developed sense of the aesthetic, and this applied to the bridge design as well.
The Japanese are very, very conscious about the environmental aspects of construction, and they are very, very conscientious about the aesthetics of any of their projects that they do. The government and the population wanted a bridge that blended and fit into the environment. I think most anyone would acknowledge that the form of a suspension bridge is perhaps one of the most magnificent shapes and forms of any kind of bridge that you could possibly design.
The 2.5-mile span would be crossed with a suspension bridge. With this determination made, they had one other major design concern. Earthquakes.
Japan as a whole is seismically extremely active. It's on the Pacific Rim, so the Pacific blade is rotating by about 2 inches every year. And so this causes then earthquakes along the entire Pacific Rim, and so Japan is prone to see a lot of earthquakes. Also, the site where the Akashi Kaikyo Bridge is clearly is exposed to seismic threats.
So it was recognized that there was a fault running in through the straits there. It runs along the periphery of the city of Kobe. It wasn't thought to be a very important fault at the time of the first construction of the bridge.
To ensure a safe design, bridge planners carried out extensive testing.
As the Japanese investigated seismic design, they relied very heavily on computational models. The advent of the computer was just one of the marvels of recent time. Computational power is without a doubt a saving grace for being able to design these huge structures. And so computationally is the best way to investigate the seismic performance and seismic behavior.
The data looked promising. The computers had vetted the most critical design considerations. A bridge across the Akashi Strait looked possible, but now they had to build it. Suspension bridges are in their simplest form, huge horizontal decks hanging from overhead cables. These cables must be supported by the shoreline. To do this, giant anchoring points, or anchorages, must be fabricated. This was the first step to creating the Akashi Kaikyo Bridge.
When you design a suspension bridge, whatever the total weight of the bridge is, it has to be carried in those anchorages. If you've got 1,000 pounds you're carrying, it's not unconceivable that the size of the anchorage, the mass of the anchorage, because that's what resists the total load, would be 10 times the amount.
One of these gigantic structures would be built on the Kobe side of the strait, the other on the Awaji Island side. Each location posed specific challenges. The first major problem was to get down to hard rock for a firm foundation on which to build. But bedrock was a scarce commodity in the area.
Typically, we go far enough down that we do find sufficiently strong material to support then the structure.
In fact, only the southern anchorage on Awaji Island would actually touch bedrock. The rest of the bridge's supporting structures were all built onto gravelly alluvium, or atop loose strata. The huge pit for the north anchorage was excavated to a depth of about 200 feet. Once the dig was complete, the pit wall was prepared by installing a retaining wall. This 8-foot-thick wall held back the dirt around the pit. Then the pouring of the foundation concrete could begin.
When the excavation process is finished and we reach the bottom, we fill the lower compacted concrete inside. In 3 months, we finished up to within 6 meters of ground level. Then we put down steel reinforcement.
300,000 tons of concrete were poured into the pit, making it the biggest structure of its kind on record. The concrete was poured in steps to allow each layer to be tamped by steamroller, and also to avoid a common problem encountered in building large concrete structures, heating.
You need to cool down large masses of concrete when you pour them, otherwise you get already, just from the shrinkage in the concrete, during the curing process, you get a lot of cracking in the concrete.
Once the foundation was poured, steel reinforcement in the top layer would provide connecting points for the huge anchorage tower to be placed on top. This structure was brought in as one pre-assembled unit by barge-mounted crane.
Since it was close to the ocean, the frames were made in a factory and transported by a floating crane and erected at once. After that, the anchor frames were set in place. To do this, we used a high-performance concrete.
The framework in the anchorage structure was so intricate that traditional concrete would have had trouble flowing between the frame members. So a new, highly fluid concrete was developed that would flow easily throughout the structure. From the top protruded the cable anchorage frame. This provided the points with which the huge suspension cables would later mate.
If you were to look at the anchorage, you will see that there's the splay block, and then those cables are separated of the main cable and individually anchored inside that anchorage frame.
Once locked to the anchorage, the bridge would transmit most of its weight there. If anything went wrong here, the bridge would collapse instantly. When the last batch of concrete was poured and the anchorage proclaimed complete, the workers held the first of many celebrations. The south anchorage on Awaji Island was built using the same methodologies, but the pit was only about 60 feet deep and rested atop granite bedrock. Next, far from the safety of shore, came the towers. The towers for the Akashi Kaikyo Bridge alone required 2 major contractors each. The design of the foundations for the 2 towers, which were to be constructed in the 200-foot deep waters of the channel, would be critical.
Whether it be for the earthquakes, whether it be for the typhoons that come along frequently in